session between two very important events, coffee break and lunch. And let me tell you that in previous programs, the third speaker was Yurko, but yesterday and today it will be Vladislav Kravchenko. The third speaker, the other speakers are the same. The third speaker of this piece is Professor Viktor Burenkov. He will talk on the compactness of cells in general modernized space.
Okay, dear colleagues, I shall start with some announcement. There will be another conference on general topics and analysis, which may be of interest for participants of this conference. It will take place in November, from 26th to 29th of November, in People's Friendship University. The title of the conference, Function Spaces, Differential Operators, Problems of Mathematical Education. And this conference will be dedicated to 95th anniversary of Professor Kudryavtsev, who is rather famous for his activities in various topics in analysis and also in the problems of mathematical education. Is it okay if I speak without this device?
Okay. It will be better if you speak with this device.
With?
Yes.
Okay. So, I repeat, 26th to 29th of November this year, conference on general topics and analysis dedicated to 95th anniversary of Professor Lev Mitish Kudryavtsev. So, the among organizers are of course, People's Friendship University, Moscow State University, Steklov Institute of Mathematics, and there are several chairmen representing these universities and respectively several vice chairmen. So, of course, there is an international program committee and so on, local committee. So this information will be sent this week to all those who may be interested. I just pay attention to the particular sessions which will be at that conference, the theory of functions and function spaces, differential operators and applications, nonlinear differential equations of mathematical physics, inverse and ill-posed problems, problems of mathematical education, history of mathematics and natural science, and finally, information technologies in education. So, of course, all of you are welcome to attend this conference. Now we close this and we open this one. And now I shall say some words related to this paper which was recently published on pre-competence of a set in general, local and global. In the last two decades, there is a burst of interest to the theory operators in general, monotype spaces, and many problems were investigated, in particular the problems of boundedness of various operators of classical analysis were investigated, and in many cases for a rather wide range of numerical parameters, necessary and sufficient conditions were obtained for ensuring the boundedness of that or other operator from one most local monotype space to another one. The next natural question is to investigate the compactness of such operators, and a natural start point for this is first of all to investigate the property of precompactness of a set in such a space. So I just recall the very basic definition. So first of all, Mori space. Here we see the norm in the Mori space. So we have a parameter lambda, which is from 0 to n over p. P may be from 0 to infinity. And a function belongs to this Mori space. Is the following expression is finite. We take the norm of a function f, Lp norm over the ball, Pxr, centered at x of radius r. Then it is multiplied by r to power minus lambda, and supremum is taken with respect to all positive r and to all x in Rn. The assumption of the parameter is a natural one, because if lambda is less than zero or greater than Lp, then the space consists only of functions equivalent to zero. So this is the classical Mori space. So the repeating cases are clear. If lambda is equal to zero, this is just Lp space, and the norms are the same. If lambda is equal to n over p, then one can prove by using the Lebesgue theorem of differentiation of integrals that this norm coincides with the L infinity norm of a function f. So, I recall the classical result about precompactness of a set in Lp over n. So, assume that p is from 1 to infinity, less than infinity. So then the classical result, going back to Frashekov, Magorov, Ries, and some others, is the following, that a set is precompact if and only if the following three conditions are satisfied. First, the set should be bounded. This is a necessary condition. This is the most important property, that you have uniform continuity with respect to translation, uniform in the sense, but the most important thing is missing in here, that of course this is the modulus of continuity, but here is also supremum with respect to all functions f in this set. So in Russian, usually the following word is used, равностепенная непрерывность. Okay. And also property number 1.3. Here we consider the LP norms on the complements of balls, ball centered at the origin of radius r. We take supremum with respect to all functions in this set, and if r tends to zero, this should tend to infinity. So this is a very classical result, but there is a variant of this result, and this variant, in fact, is rather important for us. So the variant is the following. So instead of the assumption about translation operator, so here we have the translation operator. So one may consider another operator, say a modifier, which is denoted by L delta f. So this is the average value of function f on the ball of radius centered at x of radius delta. So integral over this ball divided by the measure of the ball. Which of course can be written as the convolution of function f with some special function omega delta, which is here. So instead of condition 1, 2, with supremum of course with respect to function f in s, one can use this condition, and again this is a necessary and sufficient condition for the precompactness of a set in Lp. So our aim is to obtain to a certain extent similar results about precompactness of sets in Mori spaces and more general Mori type spaces. So I shall give some definitions. So there are two variants of generalization of Mori spaces. One is the so-called local variant. So what we do, we consider a fixed point, say it may be just origin. We take noise of functions f with respect over the ball centered at the origin of radius r, and instead of multiplying by r to power minus lambda, we multiply by just a general function w of r, and instead of taking, say, supremum in r, we consider L theta norm on 0 infinity. If theta is equal to infinity, then just supremum. Of course, the first question is when this definition makes sense, and there is a simple answer to this question. So this set for which this expression is finite is non-trivial, that is, does not consist only of functions equivalent to zero, if and only if function w, which originally is just non-negative measurable function on zero infinity, satisfies the following condition, that for some positive t, the norm or quasi-norm, if say theta may be less than one, of function w on L theta of t infinity is finite. Another variant, global variant, is related to the previous definition, but additionally we have supremum with respect to centers of the ball. So again, we take the norm of function f over the ball centered at x of radius r. As here we multiply by function w of r, as here we take L theta norm in 0 infinity, but in addition we take supremum with respect to all s belonging to Rn. So we have something uniform with respect to the centers of the chain. In this case also one can write out explicitly conditions ensuring that this space is not trivial. So by omega p theta we denote the set with the following of functions which are non-negative, measurable on zero infinity, not equivalent to zero, and which satisfy two conditions. For some t positive, we have the same condition as was for local Mori type spaces, but also additionally the condition related to the behavior of function w near zero. So w of r multiplied by r to power l over p, the norm or quasi-norm in L theta 0 t should be finite. And this space is non-trivial if and only if function w satisfies these two conditions, or briefly, function w belongs to omega p theta. Some particular cases which are often used related again to the case when w of r is r to power minus lambda. And in this case, it is also convenient to consider integration with respect to the measure dr over r. So if this integral is finite, so then function f belongs to local Mori space, L stands for local Mori type space with the summability parameters p and theta and parameter lambda. And similarly, the space, the global, g stands for global Mori space with the summability parameters p theta and parameter lambda, so this expression is finite. It again includes additional supremum with respect to the centers of the balls. Okay, so, we note also that the average of function f over the ball of radius delta clearly is such that it does not exceed the maximal function of f. Because, of course, instead of particular value with delta, you can consider supremum with respect to all positive one. I recall one of the results which was obtained with my colleagues. One of them is somewhere here, Vladimir Guriev, and some others. So let p be from 1 to infinity, theta from 0 to infinity, function w belongs to omega theta, this is a natural assumption. Then the maximum operator is bounded in the space, in local body type space, if and only if the following condition 2 is satisfied. So what we do, we take function w of r, we multiply it by r to power n over p, then we take the norm in L theta with respect to interval 0 t, multiply by t to power minus n over p. This should not exceed some constant, which of course does not depend on t, multiplied by the norm or quasi-norm of function w in L theta on the interval t infinity. Okay. And of course, the straightforward corollary is because we have this inequality that if we apply this theorem to the maximal function, so if this condition is satisfied, then we have a uniform estimate for the average values of function f via the norm or quasi-norm of function f in local monotype space. Okay, so our aim, as I have said, is to obtain the conditions ensuring the precompactness. I start with these statements. Okay, so theorem 3.1. So we assume that this condition 2.2 is satisfied, and also standard conditions that function w belongs to omega theta. So in order that a set S belonging to this local body space, body type space, Lp theta w, be precompact in this space, in order that this set be precompact, it is necessary and sufficient that the following four conditions are satisfied. So the first condition is just the boundedness of this set. The second condition is of the following type. We multiply function f by the characteristic function of the ball centered at the origin of radius, say R1. We take the Lmp theta w quasi norm of this expression. We take supremum with respect to all f in our set. And this should tend to zero if R1 tends to zero. The second condition is the one which is to a certain extent similar to the condition which is used in the classical theorems about Lp space. But there are some distinctions. The common feature is that we use not translations, but we use this averaging operator, A delta M. But the assumption is that we take the difference of the average operator minus f, we take this norm of this difference in the space Lp over the spherical layer. So ball of centered at the origin of radius R2 minus the ball centered at the origin of radius R1. Of course, R1 is greater than 0, less than R2, less than infinity. For all such R1 and R2, the supremum of this norm of the difference with respect to all functions f in the set S should tend to 0 as delta tends to 0. One more condition, which is in fact very similar to the condition which was used for Lp spaces, So we take function f, we multiply it by the characteristic function of the complement of the unit ball centered at the origin of radius R2. We take the quasi-norm in local body type space, we take supremum with respect to all functions f in this set, and now this should tend to zero if R2 tends to infinity. Okay, but this result, necessary and sufficient conditions, are under the assumption that theta is less than infinity. If theta is equal to infinity, then these conditions are sufficient for the precompactness of the set. Of course, we can state some corollaries for particular cases of this general space. And in this case, if we have the assumption that the parameter lambda of the Mori space is from 0 to n over p, then a set S in this space is precompact if and only if the following four conditions are satisfied. They are just obtained by replacing the general local Mori type space by this particular local Mori type space. What happens with the global Mori type space? So here's the theorem two. We again have the conditions which are similar to those in theorem 3.1. Of course, we replace the local Mori type space by global Mori type space in this formula, this and this, but this formula is the same for both cases. And these four conditions are sufficient for the precompactness of the set in global Mori type space. Of course, the first condition, boundedness, is also necessary, but maybe it's of additional interest to pay attention to the fact that condition 3.11 is also necessary for the boundedness, for the precompactness of the set. Okay, so, and of course, we can consider a particular case of this statement for global Mori type spaces with special parameters, p theta, solubility parameters, and lambda, the parameter of the Mori space. One should pay attention to the fact that you can, if you want to have necessary and sufficient conditions, then you cannot use translation here instead of the averaging operator. There are appropriate counterexamples. So theorem one, theorem 3.1 gives necessary and sufficient conditions, but for the case in which theta is less than infinity and p also less than infinity. And this is an open question, and it is related to the question which I asked to everyone who is here, because I couldn't find in the literature answer to this question. What are necessary and sufficient conditions for the precompactness of a set in L infinity of omega? Well, sufficient conditions are very simple, obvious, but I couldn't find the necessary and sufficient conditions. And in fact, what happens with local Mori type spaces or global Mori type spaces in limiting cases for local Mori spaces and in all cases for global Mori spaces is somehow related to this fact. If we know a good answer to this question, then we may proceed with trying to obtain necessary and sufficient conditions in all possible cases. Of course, the next step is just applying these conditions to studying compactness of particular operators in local and global Mori type spaces. So, thank you very much.
Thank you. Any questions, remarks, comments?
Yeah. Виктор Иванович, в теореме 3.2 там достаточные условия, они не ослабляются при тета равном бесконечности?
Нет, они такие же. Да. Значит, в целом пока вопрос открытый, потому что это достаточно. Вот как я сказал, для случая, вот это условие также является необходимым. Вот эти условия можно проверить, что они не являются необходимыми. Просто есть контрпример. То есть вопрос о том, как их вот ослабить, вопрос, как я уже сказал, связан в какой-то мере с условиями для
бесконечности. I want to ask you something. As you know, in the classical Lebesgue frame, this very famous result of Sudakov, where, for example, the condition 3.7 implies condition 3.5, that the uniform limit implies that the set is already bounded. Here is, do you think it's possible the same, or you just skip this?
I skip because, in any case, these are necessary and sufficient conditions. No, of course, I try to take into account what you have said.
More questions, remarks, comments? If not, then I'll thank our speaker again. Talk will be in 5 minutes.
I have very much learned because it's contributing to the argument.